This is Dr. Max Schultz, pastor of the Heritage Baptist Bible Church in Walnut Grove, Minnesota. It is our privilege to be with you now for this half hour, and we hope that you have your Bibles out and you're ready to follow along, because that's the only way that we learn the Word of God is to give it out and you take it in. We'll be back in just a moment. It is so good to be with you again this Sunday morning, as it is each Sunday morning at this same time. And again, we count it our privilege to spend this half hour with you and to come into your homes. If you have your Bibles, we would like to ask you now, if you will, if you would turn with us to 1 Timothy chapter 2, if you will. 1 Timothy chapter 2, and while you're turning in your Bibles, let me just say a word concerning the new year, if I may. You know, as the song said, rise again, speaking, of course, of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's nothing could keep him in the grave. He did rise again. And you know, as we apply this to our life, maybe 1982, maybe you've been buried under circumstances. Maybe you've been buried under pressures and things of this life, and just seemingly it was a wasted year. Well, you know, if you're a Christian, maybe you can rise again, and you can if you'll put the Lord Jesus Christ first. Maybe a lot of the things in 1982, maybe you've brought on to yourself because you have lived just strictly for yourself. Maybe the Lord Jesus Christ, and you know, you thought you could make it, you didn't need the Lord. It's been a disastrous year, and it could have been. It has been for many people. But you know, in 1983, if you'll start and put the Lord first, he said in Psalms 37, 4 and 5, if you delight yourself in the Lord, he'll give you the desires of your heart. If you put him first, he'll bring things to pass you never dreamed of. And maybe 1983, maybe this is a wonderful Sunday here to begin, the first Sunday in 1983, for you to rise again. Rise to the occasion, put Christ first, and see if things in 1983 are not entirely different than they were in 82. And the difference is the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, now as we continue here, we're over in 1 Timothy chapter 2, and we continue on our subject, predestination, as we found out that John Calvin had taught predestination, and his philosophy was this. First of all, he was right in the first half of his biblical doctrine when he said, we are saved by grace through faith. You cannot lose your salvation. You are saved by the grace of God. He was entirely right. But then he went on one step further, which is known as hyper-Calvinism, and said, those that are saved by grace are those who God has appointed to be saved by grace. In other words, he has predestinated some to heaven, and he has predestinated some to hell. But then when we had found in our previous messages that predestination was found only four times in the New Testament, and each of the four times it was referring to the rapture of the church, predestinated to be conformed to the image of his Son, of course, takes place at the rapture. Predestination has two elements. Number one, God predicted and God will bring it to pass. It is not left to human merit. And then we find that we are predestinated also to wit the redemption of our body. That takes place at the rapture. Only four places. Predestination is never in the New Testament now referring to a lost person. Only the rapture for the Christian. Now we're going to continue and examine some more verses now over here in 1 Timothy chapter 2 here concerning that God wants you to be saved. You have never been predestinated to hell. And God has, he loves the world, everyone. So let's take some more verses here as we continue this now. I'd surely write these down because don't ever let anyone tell you that you are already condemned. You cannot be saved. It is true, we're all under the condemnation of God. We're only saved to a new life in the Lord Jesus Christ, but whosoever will may come. And that's the emphasis and the teaching that the Bible teaches here. God is not a God who picks some to heaven and picks some to hell. Now, we're over in 1 Timothy here. Notice here, if you will, in chapter 2 and verses 3 and 4. We find here in verse 3, for this is good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior, who will have all men, I'd underline this in my Bible, all men to be saved. You see, it's God's will that you be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth and to look in the Word of God and to find out that Jesus Christ loved you. He died for you. And it's God's will that all men to be saved. He didn't choose just some, since we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. then the wages of sin is death, which is universal. God would be unrighteous if he chose you to be saved and me to be lost, or vice versa. But you see, it's not God's will for that at all. And he would have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. And here's the Bible, which is the truth. And the Lord Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes unto the Father except through the Son. But if you're listening here and you're not saved, and saved only means, let me emphasize this, saved only means that you are saved from paying for your own sin in hell. And just like if you were drowning in the sea, someone threw out a life raft to you, you would grab a hold of it and you would be saved from drowning. Well, since the wages of sin is death, and we find out we're all under that condemnation, then God threw out the life raft of the Lord Jesus Christ. He died upon Calvary. Now he offers that life raft and that life savior to anyone who will just trust him and grab a hold of it by faith. The Lord said, whosoever believeth in me shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. And here in verse 4, we find out he would have all men to be saved. Now let's go right on down here. There's no contradiction in the Bible here at all. Let's go to verse 5 and 6. In verse 5, the Bible tells us, for there is one God, one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all. That's all humanity. In John 3:16, God so loved the world. You see the unity of the Bible, never a contradiction. God does not say that he chosen some over here to be saved, some to be lost. He has chosen some for a service to do, and he's chosen some to do a specific thing for him, but he's never chosen certain people to be saved and certain people to be lost. I don't care what you've done. You can put your trust in Jesus Christ, and every sin you've ever committed will be nailed to the cross of Calvary. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation, and God will start you out brand new. That's your position in Christ. Old things are passed away. All things become new. Everything you've ever done in the past will be nailed to the cross, and you start out with all things new in the eyes of God. You're a brand new creation. You've been born from above. And except a man be born from above, he cannot see the kingdom of God. With your faith in Christ, you're indwelt with the Holy Spirit of God. You have a new birth. And in God's eyes, you're a brand new creation. And to start things out with the past completely forgiven and forgotten. Folks, I'll tell you, you cannot find anyone that'll do that to you. Even your best friend will hold a grudge against you sometimes. He'll never let the past escape you. How many times, some 4 or 5 years later, somebody will bring something up to you and try to make you feel ashamed of that, but God never do that. When you're born again, you are a new creation. Old things are passed away. You start your life out as a brand new creation in the eyes of the Lord Jesus Christ. No wonder we can have the peace of God which passes all understanding. No wonder we're justified by faith. We can have peace with God. And that's the kind of peace you can have if you'll turn and trust the Lord Jesus that he died for you and paid for your sins. Now, we come on down, and let's go to 1 Timothy here, if you will, and go to chapter 4. Let's just keep getting these verses here that tells us God wants you to be saved. And no one is excluded. No one's predestinated to hell. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 10, let's go here. For therefore we both labor and suffer reproach, because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially of those that believe. Other words, he died to be the Savior of every man. It's appropriated to those who believe, specifically those. Now, the whosoever are those you have a right to believe. God loves you. While you were a sinner, Christ died for you. But he wants to be the Savior of all men. And the minute you put your trust in him, specifically, it is appropriated that he's your Savior. Personally, he is. And you can be his son. As many as received him, to them gave he the power or the right to become the children of God. Now, turn with me in your Bibles. Let's keep going here, if you will. And let's go over here to Hebrews, if you will. And go here to chapter 2 and notice here in verse 9, if you will. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he by grace of God should taste death for every man. Mark that in your Bible. Christ died and tasted death for every man, not just some select few, or God would be prejudiced, and he's not. We've all sinned, and we all have a right to be saved. When Christ died, he did not die for one-third of the world, or one-half of the world, or two-thirds of the world, or three-fourths of the world. He died for every man. And the Bible teaches this, that he should taste death for every man. I would surely write that in my Bible and underline it right there. Now, as we continue on, let us go on over here now, if you will, to the book of Revelation. Let's go to the book of Revelation here, where we begin to find here in chapter 22, verse 17. We'll wait a second here while you turn in your Bible. Revelation chapter 22, and notice here in verse 17. And the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. The bride here, is the Lord Jesus Christ, the Spirit and the bride, the bridegroom. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. And, of course, that water of life is none other than the Lord Jesus Christ. But the Bible tells us here, whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. And we know, of course, that is by trusting the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the life-giving water, the one, not the water that we drink in John and then thirst again, but when we drink spiritually, putting our trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, spiritually we shall never have to drink again. When he gives eternal life, it is eternal. He does not take it away where we'll have to come back and drink it again and get saved all over again. The Lord Jesus said, if you drink of this, and that is referring to our faith in Christ, he said, you will never thirst again. You'll never have to come back and to get saved all over again. It is everlasting life. You'll never thirst again. So here the Bible tells us again that there is absolutely no one excluded whatsoever, that anyone can come. And the Bible invites us that whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. Now, if you have your Bibles, I would like for you to turn with me now over here to 2 Peter, if you will. And let's notice here in chapter 3, verse 9. 2 Peter, chapter 3, verse 9. And to see what God's will is. To think that anyone would even dream up the idea that God would pick some for heaven and some for hell. When you analyze this, then God would have to do it on the merits of the person. What other reason would God have of doing it if he did it, which he did not? That would mean that he chose you because you have some particular attraction to God and he rejected someone else. Then when Christ died, the Bible says he tasted death for every man. How in the world could it be every man if God has already selected some to be saved and some to be lost? You see the confusion and the contradiction by a false teaching predicated upon man's ideology instead of the clear teaching of the Word of God. Now, over in 2 Peter here, chapter 3, verse 9, the Bible says, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness. But he is long-suffering to us, to usward. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And the word repentance is the Greek word metanoia, and it means all should come to a change of mind. And the change of mind is about going to heaven any way that you had outside of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, here just not long ago, we sat down with a man that had a lot of Bible questions and things to answer and so forth, and was real skeptical about the Bible and so forth. And we sat down and went through it, showing it was the Word of God, how that God had predicted the future hundreds and thousands of years in advance, how that he had said the earth is round in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 22, and just showed him some things in the Bible here that really made sense, how that even in the time of Noah, that when they took the animals on the ark, that even at that time, there was no problem getting the animals because there was no fear of man in animals because he never had a meat diet up until the ninth chapter of the book of Genesis. And therefore, there's no problem getting the animals. They were not scared of man. They didn't fear man at all. And then God said in the ninth chapter, I'll put the fear unto you. And then in chapter 10 in Genesis, verse 25, he said, in the days of Peleg was the earth divided, the great-great-great-grandson of Noah. And the animals didn't have to go across the continents and so forth. They were never divided until after the flood. But just a few questions like this that were answered. And this man trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as his Savior. What a thrill it is. But he needed answers or questions answered concerning the Bible. Then he changed his mind. And that's exactly what God's talking about here. What true repentance is changing your mind about any way concerning the Bible, the Lord Jesus Christ, going to heaven, or anything else, changing your mind and accepting God's plan of salvation, which is the fact that God loved the world and gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him. And if you have any idea of going to heaven outside of God's plan of salvation when he sent Christ to die for you, then we hope you'll repent. You'll change your mind about any ideology you had and believe what God said, that he loved you and that Christ paid for your sin. And whosoever, anybody who will, if you'll just trust the Lord Jesus Christ, that he did that for you, rely upon him totally, 100%, God said, you'll never perish but have everlasting life. But this verse teaches that God said he's not willing that any should perish. I'd underline that in my Bible. But that all should come to a change of mind. And I'd underline all. You see, so many times you may have heard as a boy or a young man, or maybe you're up in years now, that you know that you can't be saved. You've done too many things wrong. God's rejected you. You're under the condemnation of God to hell. There isn't anything you can do. And that if you were to be saved, God would give you the faith to be saved by. That is a lie from the pits of hell. God does not give you the faith to be saved by. He gives you the Word of God, and you exercise that faith yourself. That's a very tricky little thing that sometimes people enter into here, that, well, if you're going to be saved, then God will give you the faith to be saved. No, he does not give you the faith to be saved. He gives you the Word of God and expects you, by your own free will, to exercise your trust. God does not give you the trust. He does not give you the faith. He gives you the Word of God, and you put your faith by your own volition into the Word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. That is a subtle form of predestination, which many times is not realized. And that leads to another thing, that, well, when I feel it, I'm going to have it. No, no, that's not it. No, you're not guaranteed that. You're not guaranteed anything from God other than the conviction when you read the Word of God. Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. The Holy Spirit will convict you in your mind, your conscience, and your soul that what you've read is true, that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. And then God does not give you the faith to be saved by. God gives you the Word. He convicts you by the Holy Spirit, and you yourself put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, or you reject him of your own free will. Whosoever believeth in him is not condemned, but whosoever believeth not is condemned already, and the responsibility is 100% yours. Do not blame God because he didn't give you the faith to believe. He never gives anyone the faith to believe. He gives us the Word to believe, and we have a choice to exercise that faith ourselves or reject it ourselves, and we stand totally 100% responsible for that decision that you and I make. But again, let me read it. He's not willing that any should perish. God wants you to be saved. He did everything for you. He paid for your sins, said, I'll make you a new creation. I'll take your sins and wash them as far as the east is from the west. I'll bury them in the depths of the sea, and I'll start you out brand spanking new. You had a birth when you was born in your mother's womb physically. When you put your faith in me, I'll start you out spiritually right at that moment. Forgive everything you've ever done. I'll never bring it up to you again. You're a brand new creation. You're my child from this day on until you leave this earth and come to be with me in glory. God said, I'm not willing you should perish, but I hope that you will change your mind and put your trust in Jesus Christ. Well, let's continue on now and get some more verses, if you will. Let's go to the Old Testament now and go here to the book of Isaiah, chapter 45, and let's go notice here, if you will, in verse 22. Isaiah chapter 45 here in verse 22, again showing that God wants all men universally to be saved. Now, not all men are going to be saved, not all people are going to, but it's not God's will that any should perish. He wants everyone to be saved. Now, notice here in verse 22, look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none else. Look to me, all the ends of the earth. Underline that in your Bible. You know, God has done everything for everyone. Christ should taste death for every man. He should die for the sins of the world universally. And that he is a Savior to all men, especially of them that believe. It's appropriated to those who accept that. But he's not willing any should perish. And here in verse 22, he says, look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth. He wants you to trust him. And you know what? You have an opportunity. If you're listening this morning in your car, your home, wherever you might be, you know the greatest thing you could ever hear in this first Sunday here of 1983 is that God loved you so much, whoever you are, whatever you've done, God loved you so much that he gave his only begotten Son, and he'll cleanse you of every sin you have ever committed, and every sin you ever will commit will be nailed to the cross of Calvary. You'll never have to go to hell and pay the eternal punishment for your sin, which is condemnation in the lake of fire. But God said, I'll forgive you every sin you've ever committed. And Paul was a murderer. God forgave him. He was a blasphemer and a persecutor. God took him as a persecutor, made a preacher out of him. And God can do the same for you. God can give you the peace that you need in your life. He can help you through these trials and troubles and tribulations that we face in this life. Everyone does, lost people as well as Christians. The difference is the Christian could go through it with a sanity of mind in this crazy mixed-up world that we're in. You begin to look around and see all the things that are passing in government and things like that. Why, it will tax your imagination, the things they're doing. It's unbelievable. I'll just give you an example. It seems like every time you turn around, somebody's putting a sticker on you saying, give me another dollar for tax, or sending you something in the mail, send some more tax, we passed another. I couldn't believe this. In Ohio here, they loaned out $22 million to private businesses. I could not believe that. Telling us that they're broke and everything else and making those kind of personal private loans. Just heard that last week. And then now we got to pay another $2 for a stamp tax just to show the county. I don't know what else they'll dream up, you know, in order to get money. But what I'm saying is this, through all this confusion and seemingly it just upsets everybody, you know what? As a Christian, we're just going on day by day enjoying the Lord Jesus Christ, knowing that he's going to be coming soon. And folks, if we ever make it through 1983, we'll be lucky, because I'll tell you, we're so close to the return of the Lord Jesus Christ at the rapture. This could be the year when all the Christians disappear and go to heaven and be with the Lord. Well, our time's gone. It's been so good to be with you. We hope that you'll put your faith in Jesus Christ. God's not willing you should perish. You should come to a change of mind and enjoy the peace of God that passeth all understanding, and know that you're going to heaven when you die.
If you're listening today and you do not know that you have eternal life, you're not absolutely sure that you're going to heaven when you die, then here's how simple that it is. God has concluded we all have sinned, that you and I. God has also said that he loves the sinner. And we find out in Romans 5:8, God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And then in John 3:16, God loved the world. He loves you. He gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him would never perish, but have everlasting life. If you realize you're a sinner and Christ is a wonderful Savior, and he died on that cross to save you from spending eternity in hell so you could have a home in heaven with him, he bought your right to live with him for all time and eternity. All he asked you to do is believe the record God gave of his Son, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Well, we hope that you'll take time to write us. We'd love to hear from you. If you're in the area of Walnut Grove, we'd love to have you come to church. Our morning worship service begins at 10, from 10 to 11. Love to invite you to our services. Our mailing address is the Heritage Radio Bible Class, Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, and our zip code is 56180. Remember our website again. It is www.heritagebbc.com. Until next week at the same time, may the Lord richly bless you as we ever pray, even so come, Lord Jesus.